Welcome to the party.
Take one group of people who think they could cook.
I'm going to poison them.
Add five dinner parties.
Did look a bit like student food.
Sprinkle some secret scoring.
He served me raw meat.
I don't like chavs.
Then watch things reach boiling point.
You understand the words shut up.
You come across pretty but dull.
How insulting.
As they battle to win £1,000.
There's going to be fireworks this week.
But we love it.
It's day three in Swansea, Wales's second city, and home to some of the finest old relics in the area. It's amazing that some of them are still standing. Must be something in the air. And the air has been getting pretty heated so far this week. Monday saw pub landlady Sharon dish up a South African meat feast, which wasn't to everyone's taste. But that didn't stop Sharon's confidence.
I don't really eat rare meat.
It's not rare, it's the colour of the swing boy.
Is it?
I don't eat rare meat either.
I'm glad that I went first, because I think that honestly would have got me into trouble if I was way down the line.
Sadly, her guests didn't share her view, and she only scored 25.
I'm here for the grand, and I'm going to take it.
Well, you can't argue with a confident woman. And in Sharon's case, you wouldn't want to. Last night, Dylan Thomas superfan Annie Hayden put on a themed party in the very house where he once lived. However, Annie failed to bring any close Welsh harmony to the proceedings.
Can I just warm this up a bit, please?
How?
Oh, you haven't done it. Sorry.
You'll have to wait for me to boil it.
No, that's going to take too long. I'll starve of hunger.
It's not going to be a good relationship. I know that I don't like her just like she doesn't like me. We clash. Hopefully, I'll be able to keep my mouth shut. And I just hope that Sharon can keep hers shut too.
The result? Annie only just went ahead of Sharon with a disappointing 26. Tonight, it's the turn of DJ, Bon Viveur and man about town, 42-year-old Nick Madge.
I'm glad I've had two nights out to see what it's all about. I could never have done the first night. I'd have been in a right mess, so I'm glad I'm in the middle. Quietly confident. I don't think I'm going to win it.
And tomorrow we see if beauty queen Samira Mohammed Ali can bring a little bit of glamour to the week.
As a host, to me, it's about fun and liveliness, so they're going to see that Thursday.
Let's hope so. And on final Friday, Colin Considine, a music producer and recovering vegetarian, will have a chance to show his mettle.
To sit and eat the food that I'm eating, where I'm eating it, and to feel comfortable as I'm doing it is something I'm very pleased with.
Well, therapy is one of the things that can be found at a dinner party, as can be seen by last night's experiment in pain thresholds.
I need to excuse my actions to no one.
What's the reason you smoke, then?
What the hell's it got to do with you?
I'm only asking.
I find that question very offensive and intrusive.
Is it time for pudding? I think in some instances, I loaded the gun and then Sharon fired it. But I think, although I was trying to have a genuine conversation about a real subject, Sharon was just using it as something to beat Annie up with.
Last night was one of the most interesting nights. I was a bit disappointed because Annie turned out to be a pussycat, so there was no challenge. What a shame.
I think Sharon now knows that I think there is a bit of dislike there. The two of them are not. It is getting to the point where they don't like each other. But I think it could go off, yeah, very soon.
But Annie wasn't the only one to feel Sharon's wrath.
I think out of all of us, that's the dark horse over there, Samira.
Me? Why?
You come across all pageanty, nicey-nicey, pretty but dull.
With all due respect...
Let it out!
I've known you 2 days, and I've been myself. I am always myself.
You implied that she was lovely but dull. You did use the word dull.
No, I didn't, actually.
Yes, you did.
No, I said dim. There's no spark. I don't know how she does at pageants, but some of the competitions she won is Miss Hair, definitely not Miss Personality, because there's none there.
So, it looks as if Nick's dinner party is going to have to calm the waters a bit. Time to find out if he and his menu are up for it. Our host is kicking things off with that famous Welsh supergroup, Cockles, Lava Bread and Bacon.
Oh, Nick.
That's wonderful. Good old Nick.
But it's a very easy thing to make, so he's very nervous, so I don't think he can mess this up.
I don't eat cockles. Lava bread is a breakthrough after last night with Annie. And bacon, I don't really eat bacon that much either.
Nick will be cooking his starter when the guests arrive, but surely he still needs ingredients for his main course. So what's he looking for here? Ah, a shirt.
That's really nice.
It's very nice.
It's very nice fit. It's got nice darts on the side.
Well, with Nick, image is very important.
When I look at this menu, it makes me think of Alan Partridge living in the hotel and smuggling his 12-inch plate down to the restaurant.
Nick is now ready to start preparation for his main.
Where's the chopping board?
Once he can find the chopping board, when he finally gets round to it, Nick's hopefully presenting steak tartare, served with homemade chips and asparagus in a hollandaise sauce.
The main course is just too much of a gamble. I think it's a bit risky. I think a few people are going to be, two people in particular, Sharon and Samira, are not going to like my main course.
No, I absolutely hate raw and cooked food. No.
Steak tartare, that could be raw steak. It would challenge me, but I would definitely do it.
No cooking of meat for Nick. He's a wise guy.
As long as he makes mine well done, I don't mind.
So Samira's going home on an empty stomach again. Nick's first bit of preparation is to get a friend in to help. This is Alison, who runs a bridal shop.
That one there, go on that one there. That one there, yeah? That one or that one?
This
that
one.
OK, that one.
Please.
OK, we should know that.
Good.
Onions there.
Having successfully found and opened the packet of diced onions, these are to be cooked in a frying pan. Next, the onion goes into the ground steak. Nick then adds newly opened mustard and Tabasco sauce.
Enough.
Mm-hmm.
Then he pours in 5 ml of brandy.
A little more.
Or not. Nick is apparently working to a recipe, although it does look more like a shopping list. Note, spoon, wooden. All the ingredients are then kneaded together by Alison into 5 attractive patties or lumps.
What's it need?
It needs you to start doing something, Nick.
How many of these is each person going to have?
One,
yeah.
I think you're only going to need 3.
And I think that's plenty.
Yeah, that's plenty.
These are then chilled, unlike Nick. They can be kept in the fridge for 2, 3 or 4 hours, it's up to you. Any mixture left over can be set aside for, well, anyone who might possibly want seconds.
OK.
If you'd like to cook like Nick, ask a friend round, or you could visit the Channel 4 website. The next step for the Mixmaster is a tomato salsa. Yes, I know it said hollandaise sauce on the menu, but the shop had run out of the packets, and this will be homemade. The team sautés onions from another packet. In goes a tin of tomatoes, baby tomatoes, and freshly ground pepper.
We're getting a good rhythm here now.
I think the size of that pepper mill speaks volumes. The mixture is then left to set. Mmm, nice.
I'm a bit apprehensive about poor Samira tonight. When she finds out about my raw steak tartare, I think she's going to seriously vomit all over my kitchen, which is going to be fun to watch.
The final element to the main course is the homemade chips, which Nick sets about in his own inimitable style.
Do you want me to prepare some of those for you? Or?
If you want, yeah. You just
let me peel, let me finish peeling. I'll finish peeling these for you because it's quite painful to watch that now.
While Alison continues with the preparation, Nick has an opportunity to show us round his house, or should that be crib?
I think that Nick's house will be an idyllic local radio DJ retreat with lots of white carpets and leather furnishings.
This is the living room, which I don't spend that much time here, really, but when I'm chilling, I do like chill out in here and watch a film. And this is my dad, who passed away about 7 years ago. I quite like having him around. He keeps me company when I'm on my own here. Yeah, it's a fun bed. Maybe they won't know it's a water bed until they sit on it. So I think they'd be surprised when it starts moving all about, yeah. Yeah. This one I like wearing for work, which is pretty Don Johnson-ish, Hawaii-ish, so it's quite pretty. I just like bright colours and stripes.
Time now to meet Stephanie, another friend of Nick's, who appears to be some kind of structural engineer.
Do you want the wooden beam to go on? You've got to have the wood on top.
Do you want the wood?
For the ceiling, otherwise it's going to go through the ceiling.
Is this pole to support the weight of the waterbed above or part of an after-dinner activity, I wonder? Back to the menu. Nick's dessert is fruit salad served with flavoured creams.
He's definitely eaten regularly at Harvester.
Oh, well, Sharon will enjoy that.
Very simple. No competition again. Not worried a bit about this.
They don't seem to think that Nick is very adventurous.
Well, this looks like the highlights from a roadside restaurant pub. And I'm really quite surprised. But if he does it well, it could be very tasty.
Nick or Alison will prepare the dessert later, but for now, Nick has pressing problems with his main course.
Yeah, I'm just trying to fill these to make them look more presentable on the plate than just a big... I reckon this will work.
Oh, yes, Nick.
Yeah, baby! Look at that! Gordon Ramsay, you're a loser!
Nick, you got some mince and onions out of a pot. I don't think that's going to worry Gordon.
I'm expecting a disaster tonight with Nick. I know nothing's going to go to plan for him. He's so nervous and he's running around and he won't be completing anything, so I'm looking forward to a big mess.
But it might not be, as Nick instructs Stephanie and Alison.
When the guests arrive, 6:30-ish, I think Stephanie should greet them. Take them upstairs to the living room.
Ah, so that's what Stephanie's doing. All Nick has to do now is lay the table before the guests arrive. Two of them will get chairs to sit on, while the rest sit on something from the end of a caravan.
And then this one.
Oh, Stephanie, don't you think you should get dressed? The guests will be here soon. First through the door is Annie.
After you, darling. After you.
Welcome to the party.
Gosh, you didn't have to dress for me.
Then Colin.
Hello there.
Hi. Followed by Sharon.
Coming in.
And finally, Samira.
Hello.
Cheers.
Coming up in part two, Annie turns up the heat.
How Victorian.
How
draconian, sir.
How precise.
Samira discovers the raw truth.
Because it is, in fact, raw steak.
Try it.
I did. So I know it's cooked.
And Colin goes for pole position. Oh! Tonight, Swansea DJ Nick Madge is aiming to win £1,000, with which he could buy this young lady some clothes.
Cheers.
Nick is hoping his simple fare will win over his guests. Aided as always by Alison, he begins his starter, as Sharon and Samira take a look round his bedroom.
Gosh.
That's brilliant, isn't it?
Whoa! Oh, it's a waterbed!
While Sharon and Samira test out the bed, Nick is testing out his frying pan.
People used to wear this years ago, but he's probably trying to recapture his youth.
What Nick is really trying to recapture is what he learned at school about thermodynamics.
I just want to mess it all up.
Shall we start there?
While they get up to mischief, what's Nick up to? He's adding the lava bread, a.k.a. seaweed, to the frying pan.
That's not hot enough, is it? It's not sizzling.
Cook it on this one, Nick, because it's a bigger ring.
Having heated up the lava bread, Alison now adds the cockles.
All the labels still on. Good God.
Oh, my gosh. And why has he got on new shirts?
Yeah, Nick has got this wardrobe full of just designer clothes with the labels on and the tags. I think he might have some sort of OCD disorder. I don't know.
Put them in with the trousers. In fact, just mess it up. Oh. Right, I didn't do that, you did.
Okay, let's go.
He's going to go there tonight, and if he finds it, he's going to be up till 6, 7, putting it in order, and that's what it's all about. It's a bit of fun. I love Nick. I want to get to know this guy after this whole experience. He needs a good woman. I'm going to find him one.
Preferably one who can cook. However, Captain Chaos has managed to successfully cook the bacon, and now all the ingredients can be transferred to plates.
Right.
It's all very stressful.
Right, we need to wash that. Can you carry on there while I wash this?
Yeah.
Finally, everyone is seated, ready to eat. But sadly, nobody told Alison. Eventually, they are served Nick's starter of cockles, lava bread and bacon.
How good does that look?
I love lava bread.
Is it traditional to have bacon with lava bread, then?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Lovely cutlery.
Mm.
I was dreading having cockles, and to be honest, I changed my mind on cockles.
I thought Nick's starter was a very standard Swansea Sunday morning cafe dish, and it was executed reasonably well.
Starter to me was very basic. That's the kind of thing I have for breakfast. Cockles, lava bread, bacon. I do not expect someone to invite me out for a night and give me that.
He didn't tamper with the lava bread at all, which is, and it's got such a wonderful full-bodied taste. A better taste than full-bodied wine.
Nick now has to move on to his main course and get those chips underway.
Oh.
Hold on, who's turned out the lights?
I'm getting chips.
Unbelievably, Nick's blown a fuse.
It's burnt out, Nick.
Right.
So, don't panic. Right. We'll ring a friend.
Okay.
Lee,
ring a friend.
Okay?
Okay.
Switch this on for me. Don't panic. We'll get another pan. Okay. It'll be fine.
Mm. So you'll deal with that, will you, Alison? Having found an alternative method of frying the chips, things are looking up.
Now, this is where we burn the house down.
Yep.
Whoa, now, easy now, Al. Whoa, now.
Spoke too soon.
Whoa, now. This is actually where we do burn the house down.
Do not try this at home.
No.
If that sink survives the night, it'll be a miracle.
That's too hot. It's way too hot.
Has anyone got a damp tea towel?
Way too hot.
Don't put it on there. No.
Why is that so hot?
Because it's been on the hob.
It's calming down now.
Unlike you. Finally, in a brilliantly choreographed routine, the team serve up steak tartare with chips, asparagus and a tomato salsa standing in for the absent hollandaise. Well, I suppose that chip on the far left doesn't look too bad.
Is Alison your daily maid, or is she, you know...
No, she calls around once every week.
Enjoying Samira?
Mmm.
What's that?
Mmm.
Oh, wow.
It's cold. It's cold. Served cold. Steak tartare is served cold.
It's raw. No, it's cold.
It's cold. It's cold.
So you cook it and then you make
no,
it like this.
No, you don't cook it.
Oh, Sharon's dropped something on the floor. And put it in the pot plant.
I've done my bit.
Well, that's
good
great.
Look at that. Look at that. Sharon, my God.
Samira.
I think the flower knows something.
Sharon's gone.
I managed to take the piece of meat and dunk it in there without anyone seeing it.
Sorry, we did, Sharon. For Samira, it's now the moment of truth. Be gentle with her.
Steak tartare stands alone as a meat dish because it is, in fact, raw steak. And it's considered a delicacy. And it's also the first time I've ever had it. Given that you didn't really know, what did you think of the taste of it?
The truth? I didn't really like it.
OK, that's fine.
It was a disaster, actually, for me. But to serve raw meat, I think the majority of people wouldn't really like raw meat.
Having been a vegetarian for the last 18 years and only recently converted to having a meat diet, I thought steak tartare was a little bit intimidating, but I invested in it and it was rewarding. I really did enjoy it.
The whole thing worked. He had the cold taste and the hot taste, and it was lovely.
I've realised that I'm really fussy with food, actually. As long as it's cooked properly for me, then I'm fine. If it's not cooked properly, I just won't eat it.
Two courses down, one to go. With all that red meat going round, the dinner conversation turns to red-blooded males.
No, but there is this whole thing, there is a cliché, isn't there, of the older man who feels like his youth is running away from him, and so he lusts after the younger, attractive woman. But I'm
no, it's not age. It's not age. It's not age.
Well, what do you think?
I like all ages.
If you're like approached by an older gentleman who's obviously got a fat wallet and a good car,
I would never use a guy. I think that's wrong if women use guys to get them somewhere.
You just put the value, the pound into this conversation.
A young woman. He threw it out there.
But you cannot deny to me that there isn't an absolute intention on the part of younger women to lure older men because older men have money.
And power.
That is absolutely.
Were you around when the suffragettes had to fight for the vote?
Equality is absolutely right.
We're not equal in what you said. You are saying that young women will look at older men with a pound sign over their heads.
That's necessary. How insulting.
How Victorian, how draconian, sir.
That is the way that the world turns.
Your world, maybe, which is a male thing, that male is supreme.
But women, because I've turned that on its head, because it's the girls who want the richer older men.
It's the older men who need the young girls on their arms.
Can I jump in here, guys?
No, I just don't want to get involved in these skirmishes. I just want to try and enjoy the experience. Tonight, it was a very stressful experience for myself, because so many things went wrong.
And what better way to relieve all that stress than... Crikey. Suitably refreshed, Colin has a go.
Never.
Back to the competition. Is that £1,000 within Nick's grasp? The specialist pudding team prepare a bowl of fruit.
Oh, Nick.
Oh, thank you.
What a treat.
Thank you.
Sorry.
What was dessert?
It was just fruits.
I thought the dessert was quite simple. I thought that on the menu, and I thought that when I got it.
After what could only be described as an eventful evening, it's time for the scores. Nick needs 27 to take the lead.
I think Nick chose a very adventurous menu, but he made a bit of a pig's ear of it, so I'm going to award him a 6.
I like the guy, so he gets a nice 6.
He served me raw meat, and he said he was a gambler, and gamblers 50-50, so 5 is fair for Nick.
Unfortunately, Annie had to leave suddenly and was unable to give her score until the following day.
I'm really sorry I had to leave very quickly at the end of Nick's party. We just had a problem in my business and I had to get out there very quickly.
Nick now needs the maximum mark of 10 from Annie in order to take the lead.
His menu was superb and I know he was nervous. But well done, Nick. He was excellent, and I'm giving him a 9.
So, that final score puts Nick on top of Sharon and next to Annie. Who's a lucky boy, then? Coming up next time, host Samira throws in the wrong ingredients.
Oh, my God, no, I'm really gutted now.
Colin throws some shapes.
Hey. Yeah, Colin!
And Nick throws his toys out the pram.
You're a disaster. She's driving me nuts.
And you can see that tomorrow at 5:30. But if you'd like to get a selection of recipes from the show, go to channel4.com/food. Next on 4, Bart tries on tomorrow night's dinner. Nice. In The Simpsons.